Physiology can also be referred to as function. And while we'll be considering many specific functions throughout the human organism in this course, one that will constantly be part of understanding what's going on is the idea of homeostasis. So in this section, I'd like to lay out what homeostasis is in a general sense to define it as we're going to be using it throughout this course. Again, function is another way to express the idea of physiology in this course, and we'll be looking at many different functions. But to begin with, let's define what physiology is based on etymology. The word physiology is composed of two major portions, physio and ology. Physio, from the Greek, means nature. It's also where we get the word physics, which is essentially the study of natural processes. But here, physio is combined with ology. As we know, ology means the study of, so physiology could be translated to mean the study of nature. Now that's probably a better definition for a discipline like physics, and physiology is the study of natural processes in the body, or the study of the nature of the body, something along those lines. There are many specific physiological functions that we'll be paying attention to throughout this course. Many of them fall under the broad definition of homeostatic mechanisms. And so I want to describe what homeostasis is at this point. A definition for homeostasis would be maintaining the internal environment. If we look at the word breaking down to its parts, homeo means self, and stasis comes from the same place we get the word static or stand, so keeping in place, so to speak. And in homeostasis, this is how the body maintains its balance points, how it keeps everything on an even keel. When something changes, homeostatic mechanisms bring them back to the way that it's supposed to be. We're going to look at the example of body temperature to explain this a little bit better. First, I want to give a broad description of what a homeostatic mechanism is. It starts with some sort of stimulus, something that changes how your body's reacting to the world around it. That stimulus is sensed by a sensor, and then there's a control center that will respond to that change in the stimulus by sending a signal to an effector, which does something. And that effector will then change the stimulus and hopefully get us back to that set point. Now, this is a negative feedback loop, which means that within the loop, a change is made, which will bring what started the loop back into a normal situation. Now, there are a couple of examples of positive feedback loops, which is where a change is made and things get further and further away from the set point, but something outside of the loop will bring things back. A good example of a positive feedback loop is blood clotting. The stimulus is the loss of blood. There are sensors that respond to that, and within the bloodstream there's a control aspect, a control center that will affect a change, and that change actually gets us further and further away from the set point, but it ends the loss of blood and everything returns to normal. It's just that what changes it, what ends the loop, is outside of the loop. There are only a couple of positive feedback loops in homeostasis. The vast majority of things are negative feedback loops, so we're just going to concentrate on that here. So if we look specifically at body temperature regulation as an example of this negative feedback homeostatic loop, the stimulus is a change in body temperature. It should be 37 degrees Celsius normally, and let's say that it goes up, it exceeds that, you get warm. There are sensors in the skin and in the brain that are looking for what the body temperature is, and when it changes, they send a signal to a specific temperature regulatory center in the brain, which will respond by causing changes, including the sweat glands will become active throughout the body, and sweat will help to cool down the body. When it cools down the body, the stimulus will then get back to its normal set point of 37 degrees, and that'll shut down the loop. Consider this question. When you feel that you've reached an answer, hit the next button to go into the next slide, which will reveal the correct answer. The set point is the value that we need to maintain within our body. So for body temperature, the set point is 37 degrees Celsius, 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit. Or the set point for your blood pressure might be 120 over 80. It varies from person to person, but that's generally regarded to be normal blood pressure. Those are set points, and when we go up or down from that value, then the body responds by trying to get it back to the normal point. Sometimes the set points and control are odd because of things like positive feedback. So, for example, the cervical opening should be less than a centimeter when it stretches out because childbirth is occurring. The positive feedback loop will cause uterine muscles to contract and push the baby through the cervical opening, which of course is going to make it stretch out further from the set point. More signals will come from the uterus to cause the release of oxytocin, which is the hormone that causes uterine contractions, and there's more forceful pushing of the baby into the cervical opening. And it'll keep opening and opening. When it gets around, I believe, 10 centimeters, then the baby can pass out of the uterus through the birth canal. But then the baby comes out and things end, and the cervix will go back to its normal setting, return to its set point. Not because of what's happening in that positive feedback loop, but rather because the event of childbirth is over.